Today, actually, we will be discussing not so much the NPD framework, in fact, not at all the NPD framework, except for a few concepts from that framework. But we'll be trying to understand something else that is happening in the context of the way in which technology is being rolled out and the kind of imagination that is being used, that's being deployed in bringing technology to this country. And that's become important, not just for this country, but for many other countries, because we are not merely doing it here. Those who are creating this are also exporting it to many other countries. It's being done directly to African countries, to Latin American countries. It's also being done through the World Bank. It's being done through multilateral institutions of that kind. So we need to understand what it is, and the big pride of what's happening in India today is that it's the first time that many things have happened. For instance, it's the first time that there is such a large ID database that has been created. Nowhere in the world do you have an ID database of this kind. Nowhere in the world do you have a program of financial inclusion like you have. Financial inclusion, even as we start, and since Benny's here, I should just say that my understanding of financial inclusion is being informed about various aspects of finance, including credit, including savings, including what you can do with it and what can be done with what you have. But of course, in this country, as I see it, it's been reduced to having a bank account and having some monies put into it and learning how to take them out of it, if you're able. So, but this idea, you know, that financial inclusion, because we have such a large number of bank accounts, that it's the largest that it's ever happened in the world, that this is the first country where we went to the extent of being cashless, paperless, and presenceless anywhere in the world. So there are many firsts that have, you know, the largest biometric database. So all these, you know, the grand ideas that, the grand notion that we have the largest and the first of all of these things is one way in which we've been introduced to what is happening in our midst. So it's the focus of what I'm going to do today, and this is something that's been holding my attention for some time now, is this idea of eminent domain. And eminent domain sounds like a technical term, and it's something that as lawyers we use all the time. So I should just say that it's actually a pretty simple notion. It's a doctrine that was created so that the state could take private land to use it for a public purpose on payment of compensation. So the idea was that there will be various circumstances where, I mean, land is not owned by the state. The state can only take some land and you put it to another use, but it doesn't own any land at all. That's how it began. But the state will have the authority to be able to take private land and put it to use for a public purpose on payment of compensation. There are various, 17th and 16th and 17th century philosophers who've written about this, political philosophers who've written about this, including Hugo Grotius and Rousseau. So we've all sat and looked at that to see at that time, what did it mean? And what has it become since? I find that a lot of us who work on technology are not fully aware of the kinds of doctrines, ideas, notions which have developed in law and in political philosophy, which is actually determining, or which will either it's determining the way things are happening around us today in relation to technology and in relation to data, in relation to our uses of technology and the uses that are being imposed on us. We are also not fully cognizant of how people have responded to these various notions and doctrines. So the idea that the state can take private land and convert it to a purpose that the state thinks is a public purpose, how have people responded to that? How have institutions responded to that? And the question that could well be asked is, why is this relevant in the context of technology? Because the uses to which technology is being put, the various kinds of relationships that are being developed and which are evolving between technology and technology controllers, between technology controllers and the state, between the state and the resource that's being created, all these have already been experimented in political philosophy before. They are not new. So to think that we are seeing it for the first time in humanity's existence, that is not correct. So just a little bit to say that this is not really to do with whether it's technology or land or minerals or water. It is to do with authority, power, and control. And that is common, never mind what we are looking at. So power, authority, and control are the three concepts which will help us understand what's happening in the context of technology, just like we understood it in the context over a period of time. It took us some time to understand it in relation to land. And there have been many ideational conflicts and resolution of conflict that has happened in the context of land over the, especially over the past 30, 40, 50 years. Why is that period important? Because it was a period of decolonization, post-colonization, where we were no longer being governed by a foreign power, but we were governing ourselves. And so the kind of engagement we had with the state and what we could expect from the state also changed. We have a constitution now, and a lot of the conflicts of ideas are located in the constitution. So those who know technology need to know the constitution, and those who study the constitution need to understand how technology controllers understand technology and what kind of imagination they have. It is my broad premise that we need a completely altered imagination. I don't think we can proceed with this imagination. And a simple reason for that is that the excitement with which we started adopting and using technologies at the beginning of this century has changed dramatically, where today we are facing a lot of anxiety when we think of these technologies. And we are having to suppress those anxieties every time we use them. We are also facing a situation where we feel that we are helpless in the face of this technology. And helplessness is not a great way for any people to exist. We are being helpless or choiceless is not a way for any people to exist. So it is to deal with this. If the technologies and the way they've rolled out is producing anxieties, and if it's producing choicelessness, then there is something that is wrong with the way that imagination has gone, and we need to alter that imagination. This is the imagination of a set of people who have worked on this and produced this imagination. There is nothing to say that there can't be other sets of people with other imaginations who will then either challenge these or contribute to these or try and dislodge this imagination while putting in its place maybe another, or at least being able to demonstrate that this imagination anyway cannot continue. So that's the, I almost said simply stated and then said, no, I shouldn't say that. So this is the complex, kind of question that's floating in my mind and which I'm taking this opportunity to unburden onto you. So now what was this about eminent domain? Eminent domain really started about land. It also extended to the idea of the forest, but it was also even the forest was seen as the forest, which is on a particular land. So it was about saying, the colonial state was saying that we need to be able to keep, we have various projects of development and expansion for which we need various resources. And we can't, if it belongs to some people, for instance, railways. Railways is like what today you would call a linear project. And if the railways had to be rolled out, and if that project of development and expansion had to move on, the state needed the power to be able to take land and anything that was on land in the way, whatever came in the way. So you find that, and this is true of forests too. So even the railways themselves, for instance, needed for the sleepers, it needed forests. And it needed the trees. It should be quite clear that it is not the forest that it needed. It needed the trees. So to capture that tree, it cordoned off lands, fenced off forests, fenced off lands, and said, any tree here, nobody else is allowed to get in there. Everybody get out, whoever's there. You are all encroachers when you're there. And this now will vest in the state. And the state will manage and decide how to use this. How to use these forests. So we've come from there. That's the heritage from where we have come. And in 1894, there was a law that was passed called the Land Acquisition Act, which consolidated all these practices. And for those who, some of you are too young to have and maybe not in the same field too, so you may not have noticed, but actually you see them even today. Every other day in the paper, you'll have something or the other that's happening. There is a whole study and collection of information that's happening by a group called Land Conflict Watch. The conflicts are huge. They are all over the country. If you look at the map with where it's dotted, you'll find that the dots are all over the country and often overlapping one with the other. So this, what the Land Acquisition Act did was it gave legal status to the power of the state to be able to take private land for a public purpose and to make it, to bring it under the control of the state without any encumbrances. This is an important concept to understand because we see that in the context of data today. That is, it will be, the land will be, there will be a process, there will be a notification that will be issued saying we want this land. Anybody can object, then they will decide on the objection. So the person who wants the land will be the person, person in the sense, the entity which will be deciding on whether they should or should not have that land. And then once it is decided, there will be a compensation that's paid into the, to pay to the person who's interested. And that interest will cease from that day. And after that, it is all under the control of the state. So this without any encumbrances is a very important notion that exists. And we are seeing that being brought into the idea of data and personal information, which when it reaches a certain point, so when you reach the non-personal data framework, you'll find that it is there. It says that once it reaches, once it reaches a certain point, after that, it's no longer anybody's. It is free for everyone to use. So in the non-personal data framework, they call it non-rivalrous. So it doesn't mean, it means that not just one person needs to use it. There is no rivalry. Everybody can use it. So it's an extraordinary kind of thing to say that data at some point disengages itself from the person and the person has no control over it. It will be among those who are going to use it for creating businesses. This is not, like I said, a new notion. So this idea of cutting off the person from what belongs with them, regardless of what is done with it after that, is a notion that has existed for at least 140, 150 years. And we are seeing that come back in the context of data. I just want to clarify one thing here, that we know that there are all these questions that are going on, which I think are extremely important and urgent questions about what Google, Microsoft, Amazon, Verizon, whoever you can think of who's got all these massive amounts of data, about their ability to collect this data, to retain this data, to process this data, to use this data, and to abuse this data. We've seen Facebook, all of them, we've seen this, this whole thing happen over this period of time. And the questions that are being asked about antitrust, about monopolies, about abuse, about having done things that they ought not to have done. These are all questions that are here today. And they have to stay till they are resolved. But it is important to remember that these companies, they became what they did because they were allowed to do what they wanted. And there were no rules stopping them from doing it then. So we are fighting with both our hands tied at the back and with very little on our side, except the knowledge that if these companies take over our lives, there is no life left. I mean, it's really like handing it over to them and that's it. After that, you can be controlled by them. Like they tell us, everything is convenient, everything is efficient. It's convenient for you not to have to go and put your signature. It's convenient for you not to have to be present. It's convenient now for you not to have to think for yourself. These companies will think for you. Amazon will tell you which book to read. Google will tell you which article to read. You really don't have to do any thinking or working for yourself. And this is presented to us as an advantage that's being given to us in our lives. I have no clue how. I mean, why would I have it's like converting many things into vestiges in the human body and in the human mind. So it's an extraordinary time. And I think the battle that we are fighting with these major companies is a very important battle. It's also a very important battle because we are seeing their collaboration with the state. If it wasn't obvious before, I think Snowden has opened it out and given to us bit by bit about what this means. So this kind of collaboration in which we are not a part, but of which we are a part, that's something that is truly extraordinary and needs to be just not just urgently, but I mean, we need something dramatic happening in that area. What we are discussing today is, there are little parts of that will come into this, but largely it is the other aspect of this which is developing and in which India has taken a lead. Now, on the idea of eminent domain, therefore, like I said, in the beginning was only about private land being taken for a public purpose on payment of compensation. It had to be, therefore, private land. What about land that is not private? That question never really got resolved. And after independence, in the early years, in 1951, we asked this question, this question was asked, interestingly, by the only people who have the wherewithal to ask the question, which is zamindars. They raised the question saying, who is the state? Is the state a super landlord? Is it some kind of an owner or a super owner that it is above the law? It doesn't have to conform to anything at all. Everything belongs to it. And what is this public purpose? You're saying you want to take it away from us. For what? The for what was answered by saying that, listen, breaking down these structures, feudal structures, doing away with the zamindari system is the public purpose. But on the question of who is the state, the question has really remained unanswered for a very long time. When the UID litigation was on and we brought that question up, the question was brought up, it was asked to say, who is the state within the constitution? What is the relationship of the state to a people? Is it a relationship of where the state will dictate and people will act, which means that there are limits to the rights of people, but there are no limits to the power of the state? Or is it the converse, that there are limits to the power of the state, but you have to have as expansive an understanding of the rights of people as is possible? The job of the state is to expand the rights of the people. The question, of course, in the context of technology and the way it's said is, which is not a question at all, I think, is convenience more important than rights, or rights more important than convenience? I think I can't think of anything more convenient in life than rights. So I don't know that that's a question at all. But when you look at what it is that happened with this, with courts saying till about 1950, till the 51 judgment came in, between 1894 and 1951, there had been a number of decisions where basically they had said, if the state says that it is a public purpose, then we can't ask any question about it. We will accept that it's a public purpose. So the state decides what is a public purpose. And so the idea of challenging a public purpose became very difficult. The second thing that happened was that the idea of eminent domain itself stopped having the capacity to be questioned, because it became entrenched that the state can take land for a public purpose. The only thing was about compensation and how much should be paid as compensation. That by now we know, anyone who studied constitutional law will know, that battling over how much should that compensation be is like we have lost the battle, because we are handing over enormous powers over resources which are very important and significant to a people, to the state. Now, what is it that the state could do with it? The state could therefore structure what it wanted to do with land. The state could decide what the public purpose would be. The state could take over that land. The state may or may not use that land for the purpose for which it said it would use it. It may or may not use that land at all, but it will no longer be yours. It will not return to the person for whom that land belonged. This is a very important concept, and it's one of those, after the Narmada movement started, against the dams, against the Sardar Sarovar dams, it's at that time that the question started being raised about eminent domain. But even then, people were just saying, don't be unkind to the people who are there. Don't be unkind to the affected population. Don't have policies which will destroy the lives of the affected population. At that time, people were still not saying, you state don't have the power to do it. You don't have the authority to do it. The Constitution doesn't give you that power. So where are you getting this power from to take everything away from the people and to make that which is common lands, like grazing land or anything that doesn't belong to a person, to be treated as if it is state property? It is not state property. That battle is an important battle for us to go back to understand what is being, what is at stake when we say that data can just become public, everybody can use it, you'll have multiple startups, and you know, and it's not your business any longer what is being done with your data. So it's important for us to see that. The it's also interesting that in the case of land, just like it's happening in the case of technology, law came much after the practices were established. And that is very significant, which means that we have no norms. And we will then make the law on the basis of what, whoever it is, whether it's the company or the government or, you know, whoever has the wherewithal to be able to intervene in this, whatever it is that they think should be in the law after having experimented with it, that is when the law will be made, which basically means law is not normative. Law is made for the convenience of those who want to use whatever resource exists. So, and that has very serious consequences, as you can imagine, for data too. For instance, the UID didn't have a law. It started in 2009. It started collecting everybody's data. It started mandating people to use that data, but there was no law. And if people hadn't gone to court and got a stay order, even nominally, there would have been nothing that they could have relied on. And if the court at that stage had said, well, it's too early, I don't really know what to say, one could have understood why not, because for the court to understand that technology can produce these kinds of effects, it would have taken more time than it would have taken, for instance, for a person who is in technology sitting there and watching. So it is extraordinary that the court did understand that there was a problem, and in 2013 gave, you know, stayed the idea of mandatoriness at least, even which was breached all the time. But some normativity had been introduced because of that. So I just want to pause at this time to say that there is a distinction between normativity and pragmatism. Pragmatism depends on the person who has the power to be pragmatic. It does away with other people's rights. So we just need to remember what that can mean. It's a very interesting thing. I mean, it's a very long story, the eminent domain and this land acquisition story. But just to know this, that till 1894, you had the law. In 1927, you had a Forest Act, which basically made encroachers of people who were on that land. And then you had the Forest Conservation Act, which came in 1980, which said that the decision to make, you know, the decision to be made about diverting forest land for a non-forest purpose will now vest with the central government and not with the states, which basically meant that it was not to conserve forests as much as decide who will have the power to decide on diverting a forest for a non-forest purpose. And then later you had the Land Acquisition Act itself being amended. And that is that 20-year period is something everyone should study, because it required people beginning to understand what was getting lost because you had that old law and how it benefited no one who was affected. Whereas it was attempting, there were experiments being done with what that land would be used for. Take the Nano project, for instance. The Nano project, they started it in Singur. Singur had a huge problem with it. People protested. They moved to Gujarat. The project failed. But for those who lost their land, it remains lost. In Singur, because they sent them away from there, they've been able to retrieve some parts of it. But it had already been worked on, and there are all manner of problems with that. So these are really what I would call burning the boats projects, where you burn what was there before so that you can't go back to it, whether you go forward or not. A lot of technology projects today are like that. The UID project is a classic of how it is like that, as in fact is the financial inclusion project, where the way it is being done now, where you say everybody will have a bank account and money will be put into that. And that's the beginning and the end of that. So what that, it's like you have no other means. If an NREGA worker doesn't have a bank account which they are able to make work, which means either your biometric has to work or your business correspondent has to have a certain training where they'll do something different. You can't be paid in cash, because now today that is seen, just payment in cash is seen as akin to corruption. So there are ways of thinking that have to change to introduce all of this. One of the very significant things in this, in land acquisition, is that, you know, it used to, people working on land acquisition used to call this, you know, who were opposed to land acquisition of this kind, used to call it robbing the rich to, robbing the poor to give to the rich. So it's like an inverse Robin Hood, you know. So why are you taking the land that the poor have and then handing it to the rich so that they can make something that may add to the GDP? Maybe it will, but it doesn't benefit all those that you're throwing out of the system. So various kinds of concepts developed around this. The idea of marginalization. In technology, it's manifesting as exclusion. And there it manifested as marginalization. And over a period of time, we found that marginalization didn't stay with the margins. It kept expanding because they became more and more irrelevant to the development project. So for those who were on that project, they were not interested in those who were getting marginalized, and that kept growing. We are seeing signs of that already in the data project. Already, I mean, it didn't require 100 years for that to happen. We are already seeing that happen. The other element of that, you know, which came after years of battle, the 2013 law, the Land Acquisition Act, that law is the first time that the law acknowledges project-affected people. And this is not people who've been affected well by the projects. These are people who've been affected badly by the project. The numbers have kept growing into millions over the years. And they kept getting sidelined till public action, public call for action, and movements from the ground demanded attention and said that you have to listen to what is being said, what's happening to people on the ground. You can't ignore those. So there are people who are land owners and people who can show a legal interest in land. They would get compensated to a certain extent, because it wasn't replacement value, it was market value. Market value will be on the basis of circle rates. So you keep having various ways in which you reduce the cost to the project of displacing people. The idea of development shifted into becoming the displacement project around the late 80s and early 90s. And it was possible to demonstrate how many people, millions of people, and invariably it would be people who can least afford to get left out of the system who would suffer the most in this. And we saw that happening in the land acquisition context. And it took a lot of, you know, lot of negotiation, understanding, getting people, you know, getting people in general to understand this, to say that we have not just people who are losing land, we are having people who are losing a lot, which is not even recognized, which is not even put into the computation. And that is how you have in the 2013 law, the idea of project affected people. Just think about what it means that 63 years after a constitution, you've had to include a category who got totally excluded from the development project over this period. The question is, can we afford to have another set of that happening with data? There is one word that never gets spoken, which is not relevant when you think about the land acquisition issue, but which is supremely relevant when it comes to what is getting lost in the context of data, and that is surveillance. It is extraordinary. I mean, we all know of the book by Shoshana Zuboff called Surveillance Capitalism. I don't think it is only about capitalism. I think in India, we are seeing a very, very interesting phenomenon, which is common to what happened with land. In land too, the state was asking the, especially since the late, you know, since the 80s and 90s, the state was asking private industry to create more and more GDP. So saying you have to create the pie from which we can distribute to others. And we need you to do this so that we are a force to contend with in the world. I actually think in the 50s and 60s, I have a certain sympathy with what happened then, because we were very, very newly out of being colonized. And we had to establish that we could exist on our own. You know, when Gandhi said, leave us to God or anarchy. That's what happened. And we had to create our own something between God and anarchy. And that was the project. And it was many experiments. And it was by the third five-year plan that they started recognizing, oh, there are people getting marginalized. People who ought to be benefiting are having to become people who sacrifice for development. And that should not be. So, you know, we have seen these processes through the years. We've learned from those processes through the years. In forest rights, it was 2006 before the Forest Rights Act came in. And the law says, this is a historic injustice that has been done. These are words in the law. Historic injustice. What was that historic injustice? That you made people who were on land, on land in the midst of forests, you made people who were perfectly legal and who had every right. Legal is what? Legal is a constructed, constructed entity, right? It's not, there's nothing, people live. So these are people who were living there who through law were rendered illegal. And they said for about whatever, 90 years, 80 years, we've been keeping you in this state. And that is a historic injustice. And they did not say they will give them land. They said, we will recognize your rights. This is something that's happened as recently as 2006. So we can't say, let's have 100 years of technology doing whatever it wants. And then we will think of historic injustices. Historic injustice does happen. Projects do affect people. Exclusion and marginalization are built into these. And in addition to what happened with, and invariably the people who get affected are the people who can least afford to take this on themselves. Increasingly, we are seeing the normalizing of various things that shouldn't even exist in a society. And that normalizing includes surveillance. I'll just move to technology itself. And I just want to say, the idea that the next big GDP thing is going to come through data. And what are the kind of systems that have been used to make this happen? The first thing we find is e-governance. So the story goes, and I will, for the moment, I will still take it as a story goes. Heather Brooks is a respected journalist, so I would take her word for it. But you should know that that's where it comes from. That after the dot-com bust, after the Y2K got over, which till today nobody knows whether it was a hoax or it was genuinely something. Whatever it was, lots of companies made lots of money from it and they gained a certain traction for themselves. And then you hear of technology companies approaching the EU and saying, listen, if you're not going to be supported, then we will collapse and you won't have that assistance either. So the EU decides in their Lisbon meeting that they're going to help these technology companies survive and they are going to draw from it too. That's when you see the beginning of, and it's like a mushrooming of e-governance projects around the world. So when anything happens in every jurisdiction, then I think we really need to sit up and take notice because it's coming from somewhere. It's not coming from within. So that e-governance project, from that time on, you find that it is technology controllers and those who profited from certain forms of technology who hold control over these systems. And one of the things that is constantly done is to make the state believe, maybe rightly, that the state has no ability to deal with technology. So all that the state has to be handed over to these private companies, which will then help run the state. And the state should let them run with whatever they have and make their own business out of it. This has become the pattern that we have here. So unlike many other jurisdictions, including the problems that we have with the Googles and Facebooks of the world. Here, there is a collaboration between the state and technology controllers. I think one thing we must acknowledge is that people who call themselves libertarians, people who say that, let's not have supervision from the state, let's not have regulation, we will do self-certification, and the state should just step off. They don't seem to exist anymore. Because what they are saying is step away from me, but step into other people's lives so that I can have what I want. Which is how this whole technology project has gone on. So mission mode projects are identified. All of them have to become technology projects. So it doesn't matter that we have a huge divide. you know, digital divide. It doesn't matter that we don't have electricity in most parts, in many parts of the country. It doesn't matter that connectivity will be low. But even more importantly, it doesn't matter that literacy should be, you know, education and literacy should be a priority. And without that, this in any case will mean nothing. The straightaway impact of that is converting a citizen into a subject. This is something we've been saying for a while, and data seems to assist in doing this. One of the questions, and the way in which data is being handled, one of the questions that has been, that we've been asking ourselves and finding answers to, is why is it that artificial intelligence is becoming such a big deal now? Machine learning, algorithmic learning, you know, everything is going to be taken care of by all of this. Why is it that it's coming now? It seems to be coming now because on the one hand, you have all these companies that are collecting all this detailed information about us. And like Yuval Noah Harari said in a recent talk, that, you know, when you, if you read a book on Kindle, it knows how fast you read. It knows how many pages you read at a time. It knows when you stop. It knows how long you take. And with a little bit of addition of facial recognition, just a camera on the Kindle, it'll be able to say whether you're bored reading it, whether you're excited, you know, how you feel about the whole thing. And it, therefore, is analyzing you, whereas you are just living. So it really knows more about you and your moods and how long you've taken than you know for yourself. You're not keeping track of all this because that's not how people live. So this, this is one whole thing. I got sidetracked with that, but I just, since I don't want to take more time than I should, I'll just move on to say that, see, there are some ideas that have come up in this period which we need to interrogate very closely. When land acquisition was happening and the eminent domain principle was being used by the state to take, see, they expanded the idea of eminent domain. They said, okay, the doctrine itself says private land for a public purpose, but actually all land in this territory, I can decide what I want done with it. So the state assumed more and more power onto itself, not even authority, more and more power onto itself. And that's the way in which the state, like all, whether it's private land, public land, community land, all of it became something that the state could control. Go to your NDPF document and see if you see some reflection of this in that document. You'll find that it is there. You know, and that's the introduction of the idea of community, for instance, only to say that communities too hold data and therefore we want to take it away from them, is a very interesting phenomenon they've brought. And it's come from people who are not anthropologists and therefore have no clue what to do with the idea of community. In this period, you find a few new notions that have come in. One notion that has come in is this idea of the state as a series of startups. It's fascinating. The idea is that, and all of these have to do with the potential of technology. So whether it is Swachh Bharat, whether it is health, National Health Mission, you can keep naming them. I mean, you'll find that there are a number that come like this, where it's like a startup. It will be handed over to an individual who's seen as a professional, who will then constitute a team for himself and then enforce the project and get it done. Now, in my understanding, startups may fail or may succeed. If they fail, they disappear. If they succeed, then to the extent that they succeed, it benefits somebody. One of the fascinating things that I find about what is happening in the context of data is that it doesn't matter if a lot of it fails. If 40% fails, it's okay. 60% will work. So for whether it's for your GDP or whether it's for control or, you know, whatever it is for, even 60% is fine. In some cases, maybe even 30% will be fine if you've had nothing before. So all these failures of technology that you find in different places become irrelevant, mainly because nobody expected it to succeed. And when they say, oh, nothing succeeds 100%, I would agree. But when something that is supposed to cover a whole population and create an ID, for instance, for a whole population, succeeds to heaven knows how much because it's never audited. And you find a government circular which says that, you know, fingerprint may not work, and that's what we are going to use for One Nation, One Ration. So if your fingerprint will not work, and there are a whole series, yours doesn't work, your family's doesn't work, there are only people above 60 and less than 15, there are disabled people, there are people who can't get up and walk. If all of these, and if you're a migrant worker, maybe with the kind of work you do, your fingerprint won't work, you can nominate somebody else to give their fingerprint for you. So these are nominated identities. Even that is not acknowledged as a problem. It is still seen as a solution. So in data, I find the distortions that are going to come in through algorithms and through machine learning is going to be huge, because some people will get left out, wrong data will be getting fed, will keep getting fed in, and you're going to have all of this happen, and it doesn't matter, because for business, that is enough. That level of accuracy is enough. It is for people that that level of accuracy is not okay. This produces the second phenomenon of what's called a self-cleaning mechanism. So the systems can't undertake the responsibility of ensuring that what has been collected is clean, good data. But if you want it to work for you, if you want your bank account to work, if you want your mobile phone to work, if you want your income tax returns to be filed, if you want to be able to do any of this and not get either, you know, become a criminal or to become, have your money frozen or whatever, then it is for you to make sure that your data is properly loaded onto the system. The system may not cooperate. So if you look at what's happening on GSTN today, you'll find that the Chartered Accountants Association is going on a huge strike, because the process that has been created, the GSTN, is not able to deliver what it was. And people are struggling. Chartered accountants are fed up. I hear, and of course I'm kidding now, that many of them have gone bald out of pulling their hair out. They do a little a day, but it happens over a period of time, right? So this tells you about the non-performance of technology, but it doesn't matter, because the ambitions in this are different. They are not about people being able to get what they want, or it's not about facilitating it. It is about making as much business as you can for the company. So when we are looking at something like the non-data protection framework, it is important to remember that there are certain things that they are saying. One, they are saying you are going to get separated from your data, or your data is going to get separated from you. Then it's with us. We are the entrepreneurs. We are the startup geniuses. And we are going to be making all these businesses, and India is going to become this great hub. And to do that, you have people who are planning these businesses, who are sitting inside government. And what does the government report? I'll just read a few things that have come up. The first is an idea of trickle up. So we, those of us who are really old and gray, dealt with this idea of trickle down. That is, you create a sufficient pie, and then if it's big enough, then it will start trickling down. So the important thing in the early years was to say that we really need to have a lot so that it can reach, you know, it will trickle down to even the poorest. That didn't happen, and we brought in a welfare state, and we said, okay, we'll do redistribution. Trickle up is different, and I'm going to just quote here. But there is something happening in India that we need to recognize. That is, this is saying beyond the market. So you have the market, beyond the market, there is something happening in India that we need to recognize, which is that Indians will be data rich before they are economically rich. Thanks to everybody having smartphone sensors and so on. So suddenly an individual has a digital footprint that is far more than the wealth he has. To whom? Therefore, the business models that will emerge in India will be those that allow people to take their digital wealth and convert that into economic wealth. So my digital footprint will become your economic wealth. And that is the trickle up. So this is a notion that has been introduced, where the whole non-personal data framework is about this trickle up. It's about saying all the data trickles up from every source that you can find. That's one. Then the ambitions of collecting more and more data so that, you know, you're going to be some kind of a global whatever house is in the National Health Stack, where they say it will potentially benefits to the central government. It will potentially place India at the forefront of medical research in the world. What? The National Health Stack. Yeah. The design is geared to generate vast amounts of data, resulting in some of the largest health databases. And then it's what you laughed at, Ambika, with secured anonymized data. By now, I think we know there is no such thing as anonymization, especially when the three massive words that were produced of unique, ubiquitous, and universal, I'm never tired of saying it, because I think we need to remember what this is about. Every person being uniquely identified, not necessarily by biometrics, but actually by number. Ubiquitous, which means put it in every database. And universal, because you can't exist without it. You can't function without it. And therefore, you have these three. This is the way by which corporate interest, business interest, technological business interest has entered government and told government to act so that it can garner all this data. It's a very interesting time that it has come, because with the present government, they see privatization as the answer to everything. It is only private companies that are going to be able to do this. So whether it is in the context of disinvestment, which started about 20 years ago or 15 years ago, or it is in the context of companies which are going to do this, you know, like who has the capacity, for instance, to run an electricity station. It's only going to be a private company. Airports, private. Ports, private. Things that were earlier seen as not even safe to hand over to the private are today being handed over, because the state sees its answer in privatization. Some of the resistance to the farm laws, for instance, is seen. In fact, people tell us these are not farmers' laws, please notice. It is farm laws. And it is because they see their answer. When they say that farmers will get more money, they could even believe that it is this privatization that is going to produce more wealth. In this process, we've also had a shift happening in what we are in relation to all of this data. So first, when the terminology came along with the UID, so it came with calling it said KYC, which was Know Your Citizen. Then it became KYR, which is Know Your Resident. Then it became KYC again, which is Know Your Customer. Between knowing your customer and knowing your citizen, that's where these rest. And it is from that. So knowing your citizen and knowing your customer has huge amounts of surveillance built into it. It is being denied again and again and again. Now, what is fascinating for me is that I think yesterday, perhaps there was the government has again given an idea that maps, making of maps can be handed over to private agencies. Earlier, it was something that only the state could do and others would adopt it. But now they've said there are different kinds of maps, that you need to have. And these maps are being created for private businesses who want a certain kind of map. It wants to know, for instance, where all the people are who want to go to a gym or who need to go to a gym and therefore have to be motivated to go to a gym. So you make a map which will indicate where all these people are so that we can take our business to them. Maybe Zomato will say, okay, that's the place for us also to go, because it means that that's where people are eating too much and therefore they need to go to the gym. I don't know. But it's that kind of personalized map that they are talking about and saying that this will help in the making of a smart city. The smart city project, as has been, debated endlessly, but with very few people from positions of authority listening, is basically, it's meant to be efficient. It has a huge surveillance factor built into it. And everywhere you'll find that they have to put in a token thing on privacy, because privacy has to be talked about after the judgment of the court. And I'll just have one little snide word at this point before I wind up, which is that, when the Attorney General stood up and at one time the Attorney General stood up and said, what makes people think that they have absolute right over their bodies? This was about biometrics, and said, what do you mean? We tell you give, you have to give. This is a very strong eminent domain principle where the state is saying your body is mine. And I will tell you what to do with it. If I tell you part with your DNA, you'll part with your DNA. If I tell you you've got to give your fingerprint, you've got to give your fingerprint. So it's a very significant kind of statement. Demonetization was another time when eminent domain was practiced. saying what you have belongs with the state. The state will tell you where you have to give it and how much it will give back to you and what it will do with you after it's found out what you have or don't have. Very significant statement. These are not just policy statements. This is about a dramatic change in the relationship between a state and a people. And that's what we are. And so now, actually, I find the non-personal data framework a sadly weak document. Not weak in terms of what it wants to do, but it almost seems to be pleading to say, please let us get all this data. You know, we'll try and do some business out of it. And I actually find that it's inexcusable that they've had this data for a very long time. Yesterday, day before, again, they've said FASTag. If you refuse to have a FASTag, then you're going to be penalized. I mean, you shouldn't have it. In a little while, they might actually, I don't know what they may do with it. But right now, they've said, if you don't have it, you'll have to pay twice the amount. Now, a FASTag is now something embedded in the car. The registration of your car will be easily identifiable because the department is selling that data to you. You have this data wherever you travel, at what speed you travel, which cities you go to, how often you go. All of that being tracked. And the libertarians in the corporate world don't seem to have any problem with it. They're pushing for it. In fact, it comes from their reports. So it's a time when I think the lessons from eminent domain and the idea that the state owns. First question is, who is the state? Does the state own us really? And every time to say, okay, the snide one was this, that they went to court and said, no privacy, okay? People of this country don't have a right to privacy. The UIDAI was represented, the government was represented, I mean, the central government, you had the finance department, everybody was represented to say, there is no right to privacy. Then the court gives a resounding judgment where nine of them say, there is no question, it's not just a right. It's not just a fundamental right, it is an inherent right, it is an innate right, all other rights depend upon it, there's no question of taking away this right. The next thing you hear is that the proponents of the UIDAI are saying, excellent judgment, this is exactly what we wanted. So if that is exactly what you wanted, why is every policy that is coming after that, I mean, even if it is face-saving, I mean, they'd gone to court and said, we don't believe people have this right. The truth is that when they went to court and said that, it was an open statement to all of us that these projects cannot survive privacy. The test of privacy, they will lose out. So I'll just stop with saying this. There is a whole lot more. I don't know. I mean, it's like a part structured, part unstructured kind of thing. But I'll just stop with saying this, that, see, today we are seeing relationship between the state and business interest, which is, you know, we've gone through many phases of this where there's collaboration of various kinds. Today, we are actually seeing them working together and refusing to acknowledge rights in people. And that is, these are strange times. This is not something that, you know, that we can see as something that will pass. If this is not addressed today, and if we don't understand what it is, and if we don't take the history of other movements that have had to struggle for so long to get where they've got, whether it's, you know, because of land, it was difficult to do that with water. Otherwise, water was getting privatized, rivers were getting privatized, and they said, this doesn't belong with you. So that battle has already happened. So we need to learn from the history of various ways in which the state and state and business interest has been construed over a period of time, or else we are going to find ourselves waiting for another 100 years to recognize a historic injustice, which I think is a bad thing.
Thank you so much, Usha. It was, I think for me, a very eye-opening conversation. Before I just hand it on to Benny, I'll urge anyone else who, we've been getting some questions on YouTube and here. If you have more, please add them and we'll just try to answer them after Benny's response on this. And perhaps before she starts, I'd also be interested if there is time to understand from both of you what it means in context of us producing the data and then it belonging to the state as opposed to the land which is already inherently existing or the water which is already there. Perhaps some insights from both of you on that would be wonderful as well.
Thanks, Usha, and thanks, Ambika. Very quickly, I have to say I'm not a legal scholar, and yeah, therefore, obviously not best positioned to kind of continue applying the eminent domain, but I'll quickly go over some points that speak very closely to what Usha has kind of brought us. But I think the caveat upfront is that we basically analyzed the paper from the perspective of regulatory theory and a very cold economic type analysis. And it's to say that even that kind of analysis has raised pretty similar questions, what Usha has alluded to. So maybe I'll keep my comments very anchored in the context of the NPT framework. Because honestly, my theory is not as strong or as impressive. So I'll quickly get down to business. So basically, as we do a lot of economic analyses and regulatory analysis, what we look for is what is the specific articulated market failure that we're trying to kind of solve for? And therefore, what is the intervention then that the government may have in terms of creating a regulator or in terms of regulating the free market, so to speak. And because I am in financial inclusion, for me, consumer protection and worldwide, consumer protection is one kind of market failure that requires the state, the government, the regulator, whatever we want to call it, to intervene in the workings of the mechanics of the free market and help basically tip the uneven scales in some sense. So I enter the kind of conversation with that kind of a lens. And here's what we found when we were going through this particular framework. The exact market failure is not very clear when I read the paper over and over, which is to say that we do not know that what is causing the creation of a full-fledged NPT regime, which is obviously requiring the creation of new institutions. It requires a full spectrum of institutional machinery. And we are still not clear what is the end objective of it and what is the market failure, the urgent need for the government to do this. Maybe it is forward-looking. And in that case, it brings us to the second question then, that what can we achieve to have happened differently once this framework kicks in, right? Once we have the data trustee, once we have the entire ecosystem of the communities of the data trustees, of the HVDs, how is it that there would be anything different or what the end outcome would be? How do we even envisage that, or how do we then actually assess it is kind of unclear. So I'll quickly make very short 3 points that I have. First of all, it's not very clear that what is the case for actually mandating private entities beyond a certain threshold to first give away the variety of data that they are collecting, and then if there is interest in the variety of that data, making some data fields public or giving away some data fields. We do not really understand the rationale. I mean, of course, there's this whole philosophical, political, economic debate, but even the cold economic rationale of that is not clear. The reason that I say that is that in a couple of jurisdictions, we've seen that there is a case to be made that whatever data is collected by the government must be made public. The rationale there is that the data that the government collects has the exchequer's money behind it. So, the entire machinery that you set up to collect that data is actually funded by the citizens. And therefore, that data should not be the property of the government. So it's a little bit reverse of, the eminent domain in some sense, that it should not be the property of the government. And if it can be opened up in a, in a gradual manner, with kind of caution to all kinds of risks that could come. And if you could still open it for public use, then government must do it, because ultimately the government doesn't really own it and it's the public's money that has gone into collection of it. So there is a case for opening up public correctly collected data, right? And then there is like conditions on what is public good and how much data can you share and what kinds of data you can share. And there's a sliding scale in the case of Australia that if the sensitivity of data is too high, then that can't be shared. If it's too less, then it can be shared only within government departments, like so on and so forth. And there is a clear roadmap there. Here, what we're not able to understand is that what logic is kind of, you know, backing this whole ask of saying that private entities will make their data public. One is asking for rationale just for the sake of rationale to be able to kind of assess the merits of intervention itself. The second reason why we're kind of talking about it over and over is that, in fact, there is some academic literature to show that maybe, you know, opening up data sets or requiring competitors to share data, there are instances where this has actually made the market less competitive, and it has made it easier for providers to collude, you know, because they share not sensitive personal information, but strategically sensitive information. So then you can actually see which products are being demanded the most, what is the price that your competitors are asking for, and then there can be an anchoring effect. So there could be all those anti-competitive effects of actually sharing strategically important data and putting them all on a data set, because a lot of consumer surplus, and I don't have a kind of a theoretical backing to say this, but this is my hunch by reading a couple of things, that a lot of consumer surplus also gets generated because providers don't necessarily know what the consumer's reservation price is. Right, so they assume that the consumer is not willing to pay as much money, and therefore they downprice their offering. But once you actually see that other people are able to charge a markup and still get customers, then what you're able to see is that the general average markup in the industry can go up. And this is actually a case that the EU is currently looking on. It's called Insurance Ireland, where what has happened is that insurers in Ireland, they created a group, and that group was actually exchanging data amongst themselves. And that revealed a lot of strategically important information, and the group was able to better signal pricing and product design. And the EU is currently seeing if that had huge anti-competitive effects, and if there was a loss of consumer surplus because of that. So not only are we not able to clearly say why we need NPD, there is also a fear that this kind of an arrangement can actually lead to the reverse, which is, you know, it can actually facilitate in some sense collusion. So then, you know, not knowing why we're even doing this or why this arrangement is important becomes even more important, because there is absolutely no sense of what we are trying to solve for here. And the downside of it is now becoming clear. So that's just one point, that we don't know legally as well as economically what is the merit of asking private enterprises to open data and what its potential downfall could be. That's just one. The second, and actually when Usha was talking and taking us through the eminent domain bit, this bit resonated quite well with me, because as we looked at the long laundry list of public use, we didn't know if we look at the definition of public use in this paper, it's framed very widely, and almost anything and everything could fit into it, right? So if you're a private entity, but your business could actually benefit through financial inclusion, for instance, then you could get data, you could get access to HVDs under this data set. So, and that's just financial inclusion, because that's the one, I mean, it's just occupational hazard, but there are a couple of other things on that list, right? So it is to say that any private entity that remotely works in the proximity, like you don't have to be path breaking, or you don't have to say that there is a demonstrable public good that I'm actually, you know, here to provide for, and I absolutely must have access to that data. The current framing of that public good is extremely loose. So then what you're saying is you're trying to invite more people in, which is great, but I don't know if inviting people in by making the data of incumbents open is the best or the most competitive strategy that is out there. And we need to measure both the pros and cons of it. And there is no, you know, very, and there is no principle-based thinking of what is public good use of, you know, at what stage do you need to come with a proof of concept and say that if I were given this data, then I'd definitely be able to deliver. Or there is no, and it's beautiful because it's non-personal data, right? Like for personal data, no matter how hard we struggle to adhere to principles, there are well-established principles of data protection. Non-personal data seems to have absolutely no fetters. So there is no talk of data minimization. There is no talk of purpose limitation. We also see it in consent that, I mean, no matter how ineffective consent is, this one is even worse because it's like a blank check consent, right? You don't even know which all parties will get your data later or what use they might be put to, but here, give us your consent that you're okay with it. Like, it is completely broken down. It is absolutely not a lever of accountability. So there is absolutely no principle level friction or fetters that have been thought through in how that data would be used. Even if one buys the first premise that it needs to be put in the open, then who gets access to that data? There doesn't seem to be a lot of principled thinking on it. I think the third kind of similar point that we came up was that the sharing of data is considered as an unadulterated good, as if, you know, nothing bad could come of it, which is quite interesting because as we talk to more providers, at least in the fintech space, or even actually more and more empirical research happening in this field tells us that the diminishing returns to data is a thing. Like each, marginal utility of data declines and each data point doesn't have the same value as the previous one. In fact, it's likely to add lesser and lesser value as the quantity of data increases. So on the one point, the business value of data, so to say, for the lack of a better word, is not necessarily going up as you're increasing the quantity of data, but the risks of privacy are definitely going up when you are increasing the quantity of data. So it's quite odd to think that you're definitely, even if optimizing for economic value was your only objective, monotonic, and more and more economic value is not being tapped as more and more data is being shared, but definitely more and more privacy is being risked. So then if those two are known facts, how are we still in a position to say that we need data to be floating around and, you know, it needs to be widely shared? Because there seems to be, I mean, we need to take a step back and kind of look at the two next to each other and see where the optimization is and where we really need to draw that line. I say that even more because I think that eminent domain, and again, I'm not a legal scholar, but and I don't know how much flack I'm going to say for what I'm going to say next, but this is my thinking, that in some sense, people can never be fully compensated for the land that was taken away and that's known. And it's not just a parcel of land, but the rights it represents and all of that. But in some sense, land does have some severability and, you know, some fungibility, which is to say that, okay, that land once taken from the person, this continues to be theirs. And at the same time, in a very limited sense, another parcel of land can be given. It is fungible, not to a great extent. I mean, if today someone was to kind of evict me from my own house and give me another house, it wouldn't be the same, and I know that. But it's all the more dissimilar for data on both counts, right? Because there is never a disassociation. You cannot sever it from me. There is no severability. And it's not fungible, which is to say that tomorrow, if my data is leaked, you can't say that here, take 10 new data points about you. It's not going to work out like that. So I think that this problem is, if there is such a thing, it is more enduring and more transformative than eminent domain, because it is irreversible on many counts, on many more counts, and that has not been taken into account at all. The like the report begins with saying that it has two objectives. One is to kind of protect communities from the harm from data, and second is to give the communities the help them basically leverage the value of their data. However, the report has a very narrow conceptualization of harm. In fact, it doesn't define harm to begin with, and the only kind of harm that it does talk about is privacy harm. And it's quite it's a hard one to kind of wrap our arms around, because we know that anonymization, it's not perfect, right? Even if it worked, it's never going to be perfect. And therefore, the privacy risk never really goes away. The privacy harm never really goes away. And it's an admission in the report itself. So you know that the privacy harm is inherent. It might be high or low in some cases, but it's always there. And then given the harm, you are taking the decision to go for the economic benefits, knowing very well that the harm is very much there, can materialize at any point, and knowing that we may not even be able to gauge the full magnitude of the harm beforehand, right? So it's the report itself is kind of conditioned on a conflict that the harm is definitely there, but there is economic gain to be made. But there is no inherent principle that says that how do you weigh between the two and how much privacy harm is okay? What is your risk appetite? And how are you deciding that? Because as Usha said, privacy is an innate right, right? So just how much of it is tradable, and that kind of a thinking doesn't come through at all. These two are taken separately as if one had to do nothing with the other. And that's the only kind of harm, interestingly, that the report talks about. There is no other kind of harm, but we do know from our own experience, cab hail companies being called by courts to say if they discriminate, if there's differential pricing. That's a very small example, but we do know about how things have panned out in the world, that with data harms strike very much at the center of human rights. There is discrimination, there is systematic discrimination, there's marginalization, exclusion. None of those harms are talked about. And so I don't know if there are any kind of control knobs in the system that will glow up, that will dial up if those kinds of harms are high. And that would basically come into the consideration of saying, no, this is an HVD that should not be created at all. Right. So that's the other part. And then the whole, I think, why personally I am finding it a bit hard to kind of make peace with this framework is because the whole point was to give life to community rights. But I don't think we did quite achieve that in this framework. One is because our whole understanding of community is, it doesn't map onto how communities are created actually, right? So the closest parallel that I can think of is probably geographical indication in IP. Like they want to do something like that, that, you know, this is a community and the rights belong to this community. But the great thing about IP is, and I don't know what its redistributional effects are again, but the great thing about IP is that to some extent, the community is organic and the people know that they belong to that community, right? So the right itself is germane because it comes from the acknowledgement that we are a community. But actually, when I come to NPD and when so many people's data are just, you know, enmeshed together and people don't even know what's happening to their data, there is absolutely no sense of community. People don't know which communities they belong to. I could be a diabetic, I could be a rash driver, and I could be, I don't want to implicate myself any further, but I could be both of those. And therefore by this report's counts, I'd be at least in three data sets, right? I'd be in the diabetic data set, I'd be in the rash driver data set, I'd be in the resident of Delhi data set, right? Now, which community am I a part of? And when a harm, when I suffer a harm, how do I know that which community's data was used badly? And which rights of mine were infringed, and whom am I going to basically go and galvanize and say, hey, our rights have been, you know, violated. And this also brings me to your point about the NGO, about menstrual rights and health. So if I were to take that analogy, then this framework requires that Mothers NGO actually have all the technical know-how, capabilities, etc., to first host an HVB, which I think is a huge barrier anyway. If we wanted to bring the marginalized, I mean, if we really wanted to invert the flow of wealth and benefits and for it to reach the last mile, then this framework is a no-starter, I'm sorry, but how will someone actually create a Section 8 company, have cloud computing, have a cloud storage, all of those technical, and then be, you know, on their toes always to actually ensure that it remains anonymized, nobody identifies it, all of that goes into it. And interestingly, there is no mention that the government will actually help upskill or provide infrastructure to marginalized communities who might be interested in, you know, putting their data out there. There is no notion of that. There is a notion that a government can be a government department can be a representative, or a Section 8 can be a representative to be a data trustee. And then you need the support of minimum members of the community to kind of give their blessings and for the thing to come to life. But a criteria of minimum number of members does not say that the most vulnerable members give their blessings. Right. So even within the community, then, like, we are basically reproducing all the social structures that are there right now, and we're reproducing them in the virtual world as well. And it's not solving anybody's problem. And then if I dig deeper in the data trustee framework, we don't know how representative the data trustees are going to be. There is no kind of support for marginalized communities to have their data trustees. And then there is very little, you know, to say that what the consultation process would look like, how would they make decisions, what happens if you disagree with the decision of a data trustee. Like, all of that, I know there is some amount of legal jurisprudence on data trustees, but as I understand it, and please correct me, Usha, but as I understand it, is that it has to be left for the members of the trust to kind of, you know, for it to be hashed out. And in the absence of a template, in the absence of guiding principles of how the data trustees must operate, there is a huge fear that, you know, those people who have agencies will end up capturing institutions. So their entire representativeness appears to be fragile to me. That's one. The second is, because communities online work very differently than communities in the real world, where online people don't even know which communities they belong to, the whole idea of community rights is very weak. And therefore, if you had to galvanize people for grievance redress, to hold your data trustee accountable, all of that, or to make sure that your voice is heard as a stakeholder, all of that is immensely hard. Even for people like me, when we've heard about consent fatigue, when we've heard about all of those things, I don't know, you know, being part of like 20 trustees, how many of us are going to pay attention to who's using my data, how? And this is us. So of course, and we are not the mainstream, and we are not by any stretch of imagination representative of the representative Indian, right? So that's the second level of problem. The third level of problem is that the benefits that accrue to the communities. I think, again, there is a lot of vagueness. In my reading of the paper, I could only find at best indirect benefits, that there's going to be innovation and everybody, it's a rising tide and everybody benefits, right? But there is no one-to-one mapping, but the harms are very one-to-one mapped. Right? So it's like the risks are highly concentrated, but the benefits are not, and which is not to say that the whole thing should be transactional, but it is to say that you still can't kind of, you know, there is still a burden on you to redistribute this, because there is no automatic mechanism in this framework that makes sure that the benefits are transferred to the most vulnerable or the people who contribute to most data. For instance, I have a feeling that, I mean, women users, okay, fine, our proportion is less. I know all about digital divide, but even by our proportion and by our representativeness in our data footprint, we'd be surprised if we got equal amounts of innovations for us, right? So, I mean, there is nothing to say that all the systematic imbalances that already exist, there's nothing in there to correct it. So, there's this, these four problems, basically, the lack of a rationale for wanting private sectors to give away their data, the wide description definition of a public good, basically considering that sharing of data is an unadulterated global good, and the whole weak conceptualization of community, or in fact, a lack of nuance in defining an online community and thinking how they're going to work out. Like, these for me are the four biggest kind of challenges that this framework has mounted for itself.
Sorry, I'm interrupting you. I think we just have about 6 minutes left. Okay, I think Usha wants to respond to you. I'm sorry, some of you have sent some questions. Maybe I'll quickly read the responses and observations out, Usha, and then you can close it off and I'll just say a thank you. So there is some very interesting thought processes where people are saying that perhaps the sale and the cost of maintaining the data platform will be so high that eventually the state will have to sell everything and we will eventually also become slaves. Like surveillance in to prevent terrorism, there is a lot of data collection without proportional reward. Of course, we've spoken of this a bit more. Another question from Ani Dalal is saying that, is there a possibility of open source data, smart city platforms, etc., frameworks to be developed as a response to this conundrum? Finally, Nadika also mentions that how I'm looking into that point of land for development and the recourse around it, but how NPD doesn't recognize that the data principal or individual or the owner of the data can get that, and it's become this amorphous floating thing. Some things that are coming out. I'll quickly, Usha, I'll just give you 4 minutes and then a quick 1 minute to say thank you to everyone.
1 minute to say thank you, you don't need. So, I'll be quick. And I really think those questions are they're good discussion points, and I feel bad that we can't go down. But I just want to say 3-4 things quickly, not necessarily just in the contradiction to what you're saying, Benny, but to clarify some things. First is that you were saying government information must be public, and that's a common understanding, and it's because the exchequer pays for all of this. I think there might be 2 points of view on this, that the whole right to information came in because we were looking for accountability and not just for transparency with no other purpose. And what we are seeing happening now is because they're saying, oh, money is coming from the exchequer, the people who are being made most transparent are the poor. And if you look at many databases, you'll find that the last 4 digits of their the bank account number will be there, the last 4 digits of UID will be there, the code of the bank branch will be there. So what else is left for you to know about them? So there are various ways in which you can actually aggregate information on this. And I think it is important to recognize that there are communities of people and communities of interests who've been saying, we do not wish to have this kind of convergence of our data being possible. This takes us back to the land acquisition question, because the idea of the state as a custodian and not as an owner of the land is a very important, it's not theirs to give. If I leave it with the state, it is still mine. So you can't say state has it, they used taxpayers' money, therefore give everything to everyone. I think we really need to have a long, hard discussion on this. The second is that we've gone through phases. We went through the data sharing policy in 2012. See, the thing is, UID was a starting point for many of these, you know, with you fill in a word and these ideas, yeah? So the first is the data sharing policy, which came in 2012, where they basically said whichever department holds data, they are the owners of that data. So when did we hand over ownership to the state? I never did. So that's one. Then we come up with the idea that data is a public good, and therefore it has to be made publicly available to be used for the public good. Before then, you have the Shri Krishna Committee report saying that, well, you have individual rights so that you can hand it over to the community. Then you have data protection law, which says we will collect everything and then be careful with it, but you have to give us all that we ask you for. Much before all of this, you have a Collection of Statistics Act that says, give me all your information. If I ask you, you have to tell, otherwise you go to jail. This is a 2008 legislation. And then you have now this, actually I was fascinated to hear you, because it doesn't seem like there's any, this document really has only one place where it should go. You know, not the waste paper basket, but the shredder. And it really sounds ridiculous. I read it and try to be very, you know, good and kind. It's very hard. Then we also need to remember that they are, you know, now we are talking about health ID. We are talking about vaccination certificates, which are going to be global vaccination certificates. The ambitions and imagination of today are not coming from the people. It is coming from people who want to be able to manage and control and know the people. It is the story of Red Riding Hood. And let's all go back and read it and see when grandma was asked, why do you have such big eyes, grandma? What did she say? Yeah, what did the wolf say? And I was thinking, you know, that when you were talking about competition, I'm not sure that that should be the basis on which we think about whether something is good or bad. It can be an element which comes after you've said some other things are all right, but it can't be the starting point, I felt. The other thing is that, okay, we all have to say it, so I'm going to say it too. Anonymization does not protect anybody. You've said it, you know, and the A and the B have said it. It has to go all the way up to U and Z, so I'm being the U. It's just not okay. It is not even a fig leaf. And so we should just, you know, one of the most interesting concepts that has come in recent times is this idea of presencelessness, which came along with the financial inclusion thing where they said cashless, paperless, presenceless. Like it is something that is good. Many of the communities that you were talking about and much of what we are talking about in terms of poverty, in terms of marginalized, impoverishment, exclusion, all of that, those are all places where we need intermediation by state. They are saying now we will do disintermediation because we are introducing technology in the place of the administrator. Who will know you is the technology. Who will know you is not the person who's going to administer all those policies on you. Think about what this means. There is a very important distinction that's been made between data as property and data as right. And the reason that has come is because it took a long time for land and related interests to be converted into recognition as a right. That was the battle. It's not just property. So we shouldn't fall into this trap of making data into property. It is not property. It's a right that, you know, it has to fit within the rights regime that people have. You said that, you know, land is kind of reversible, data is not. Actually, which is why I was saying that when they say we cut you off from your relationship with land and then you change it, you know, if they were going to bring down, if they're going to mine an area, for instance, you're not going to be able to restore it and give it back to those people. So it's a very, there is a lot in that sense too that is similar, which we need to look at. And the last thing that I'll say is, you know, about harm. It's not only that they recognize the harm, but it is also that they are saying when something may harm us, when you make the law, don't make that law. Don't make us liable for anything. So it's fine if harm befalls somebody else, but just remember we are good guys. We are not doing it to cause harm. Harm is just an incidental thing. Sometimes maybe it's terrible harm. The most important thing in all of this is basically they are now willing to convert all that is ours. Now, this is the, I don't know if there is a bastion beyond the bastion of my personal information. My biometrics have gone, my, you know, bodily information is now going, all my data is going. Is there a bastion beyond this? Is there any further to go? Anything else that the state can lay an eminent domain claim on?